Adam Frank, and I am a professor of astrophysics at the University of Rochester. I do a couple of different things when it comes to science. I study how stars form and how they die. And I also now I'm doing a lot more work in planets and the evolution of the atmosphere of planets, as well as now getting even deeper into astrobiology. And then I have a second career as a writer. I've now just completed my third book, Light of the Stars. But I've been doing popularization of science for a long time, writing for places like Discover Magazine. And now I do, semi-regularly, the New York Times, The Atlantic, and NPR. I do commentary for All Things Considered. When I was 5 years old, I found my dad's science fiction pulp magazines in his library. And there were pictures on there of, like, you know, guys in Michelin tire man spacesuits bouncing around on the moon. This was, you know, 1967. And it just blew my mind. And that was it. I was 5 years old. And, like, that was it. I was going to be an astronomer. There was no choice. Never wavered since then. The work we're doing recently, which I find really interesting, which is how planets, the atmospheres can be evaporated off into space. So we now know that every planet in the sky or every star in the sky has planets orbiting it. And some of the planets, if they're close enough to their star, the light from the star will actually heat the atmosphere up and it'll boil off. And so we've been studying that process. And it can be very important because you could start off with a planet like a Neptune. And it could boil away enough of the atmosphere that it would turn into an Earth, because Neptune is basically this big ball of gas with a rocky core. And so watching that process has actually been really interesting. We've seen some really new kinds of physics occurring in there. And it's just been a gas watching, no pun intended, watching the gas boil off. The Drake equation was basically, what's interesting about the Drake equation, is an equation that at the end gives you the number of civilizations that are out there right now that you could communicate with. And it was written down by Frank Drake as a way of organizing a meeting, actually. In 1960, he was asked to lead a small meeting on interstellar communications. And, you know, he was trying to figure out how should we have this meeting? And he wrote down this equation, which has seven different terms in it. They're multiplied by each other. And each term is a subproblem that you need to answer in order to get to how many civilizations are. So the first term is the rate of star formation. The second term is how many of those stars that have formed have, or the fraction of those stars that have planets. The next term is the number of planets in the right place for life to form. And by that, we mean liquid water forming, liquid water being available on their surface. And then there's the fraction of those planets in the right place for life to form, where life actually does form. Then there's the fraction of that life that goes on to become intelligent. Then there's the fraction of that intelligent species that actually go on to build a civilization. And then finally, there's that lifetime, the average lifetime of a civilization. So each one of these terms was something that Frank Drake thought, you know, okay, if we can answer this, then we have that number. You know, we'll be able to have that number. Now we'll go on to the next number. We'll get that number. When he wrote down the Drake equation, only one term of the seven was known, and that was the rate of star formation. We knew that there was, like, you know, one star forming per year. What's been amazing in the last 20 years or so, or just the last 10 years, the other two terms, the next two terms we've nailed. So now the fraction of stars that have planets, one. So every star in the sky has planets. And then the number of habitable zone planets, Goldilocks zone planets, planets in the right place to form life. And we know that number is one in five, which basically means if you count up five stars, one of them has a planet in the right place for life to form. So that's amazing. That's a lot of knowledge that we've gained in just the last, you know, 20 years for this, you know, amazing problem. So, that's changed things a lot. And what in 2016, my collaborator, Woody Sullivan, and I said, you know, that ought to be worth something. How can we use that to sort of move forward with the Drake equation and ask something answer some kind of question about life in the universe? And what we did is we were able to figure out how to manipulate the Drake equation and ask, you know, as I was saying, you know, in science, you can only answer the questions for which you have the data for, right? And so we had to figure out what question could we answer given this new data that the telescopes, things like the Kepler satellite had shown us. And here's the question we could answer. How bad does the probability per habitable zone planet have to be for forming a civilization in order for us to be the only time there's ever been a civilization, right? You know, like what you know, we call that the pessimism limit. How bad does it have to be? How unlikely does it have to be for us to be the only time that a civilization has ever occurred? And it turns out that number is 1 in 10 billion trillion. It's really just 1 over the number of habitable zone planets. So here's the thing, the way to think about it. Nature, in his or her, you know, wisdom, knows what the probability is, right? It's based on chemistry and biology, and you know, so there's some probability out there. If you, if I give you a planet, you know, and you can tell me if you knew, if you talked to nature, what the probability of forming a civilization on it was. As long as that's bigger than 1 in 10 billion trillion, then it's happened before. Then meaning us. Right? So 1 in 10 billion trillion is a pretty small number, right? So as long as the actual nature's probability is bigger than 1 in 10 billion trillion, we're not the first time it's happened. So, you know, what that tells you is that as long as nature is not, you know, perversely biased against forming civilizations, it's happened before. And that has huge consequences for us. Even if, like, they're all gone, it still tells us that what we're doing here on Earth, particularly when it comes to climate change and affecting the planet, this experiment has been run before by nature, perhaps billions or trillions of times. So we're just like the next experiment in this civilization-planet interaction, you know, experience. What is a civilization, right? You know, what generic things can we say about a civilization? How can we apply our understanding of science to the history of any civilization, right? You think like, oh, that's crazy. There's nothing we can do about it. We don't know, you know, do they have 8 hands or 6 hands? Are they, you know, what kind of social, are they hive minds like insects? Are they, you know, communists? Are they warlike? We don't know anything about that. And that's totally true. So those questions are hopeless. Right? If you want to ask about are they warlike or not warlike, I have no idea. But if you want to ask what kind of impact they have on their planet, well, that one's actually we can say something about, because a civilization is just a way of harvesting energy and doing work, right? If you're a civilization, a technological civilization, you are finding energy on your planet, you're harvesting it, and you're in some way or another, you're using it to build buildings or, you know, at the most basic level, you're using it to be able to have more alien babies, basically, right? So that part, we understand how planets function very well now, right? Because we've been studying the Earth for a long time. We have Venus, we have Mars, we have Titan, which is a giant moon of Saturn, which has a methane atmosphere, and then we've got all the gas giants. We know a lot about how climates respond to inputs. If you drop a giant, you know, asteroid on a planet, we could figure out how the climate would change. So in this sense, civilizations are nothing more than a perturbation, a change, a kick on a planet's climate. And from that, but you know, it's not a stretch at all, based on what we understand, to say that if you built a civilization, if you built a, as I like to say, a world-girdling civilization, if you built a civilization like ours that is harvesting a significant fraction of the energy that the biosphere is already using, then here's the thing. What we know now is, how could there not be an impact? Right. Once you start consuming, as you know, a significant fraction of the sort of the global budget of energy, there has to be an impact. It's the second law of thermodynamics. You can't use energy and not expect there to be an impact. So that's why. In fact, I can go further than that. I can actually run models because I understand how climate functions. I can actually do simulations or models of how the climate would respond, and that's one of the things that I talk about in the book. We did some research on that. So there's basically two stories that we have about climate change. The first is, science denial, that it's not happening. And the second one is that, you know, we're horrible. We're a virus. We're, you know, a plague on the planet. And, you know, from this perspective, what I like to call the 10,000 light year perspective, climate change, you know, we didn't change the climate because we're greedy and we're monsters. We should have expected that we were going to change the climate. It's a natural outcome of building this kind of civilization. So the whole framework in which we discuss climate change now shifts in a way I think that could be much more positive in some sense. That you know, the question is not, did we change the climate, which is what, you know, when I have to deal with science denial, that's what I seem to be arguing. It's like, of course we changed the climate. Now the question is, are we smart enough to make it through? Any civilization will trigger their climate change. Triggering climate change is actually it's the sign of your maturing. Right? It's the sign of your being a cosmic teenager, and you've just been given the keys to the car, right? And now the question is, do you drive the car or the planet off a cliff? So any civilization that reaches this point of maturity in terms of its own capabilities will trigger climate change. Now the question is, do you have the wisdom to make it through? And that flips, you know, instead of having to have these ridiculous arguments about is climate change, you know, climate science a hoax or not, now you can say, like, look, you know, climate change in this weird way shows how powerful we are. We should be, I know it sounds weird, but we should be proud of triggering climate change. It shows that we've evolved to a certain point in terms of our capacities. But the question is, are we now smart enough to see what we've done, change from one energy infrastructure to another, which is really all it's about. It's like, you can't use fossil fuels anymore, figure something else out, which is, we already know what we need to do. So it's, yeah, are we smart enough now to make that transition? But the question is no longer, did we change climate? Or did we change climate? And it's not like, oh my God, we're horrible, evil creatures for doing so. Well, it's interesting. I mean, in general, scientists play this foundational role of creating the technologies and the knowledge that we use for everything, right? It's always remarkable to me that sometimes people will just forget how prevalent science is in their lives. I mean, it's been that way for the last 150 years, but now, my God, where's your food come from? There's that plug over there, and you just plug something in and then magically things work. Your cell phones, right? I mean, that all of this stuff comes out of scientific research. So, you know, scientists play a fundamental role in creating the conditions under which we all live. So there's that role. And then the question is, what role do scientists play in terms of educating people? And, you know, what's interesting about, we live in a very weird moment right now where people suddenly, you know, because of the tribalism and the polarization, suddenly science has gotten thrown into that, which is a little crazy to me, where, you know, after World War II, there was sort of a deal that science and the government made, which is like the government was like, okay, we'll give you money to do science, and you produce stuff that makes us, you know, a wealthy, prosperous, and strong nation, and we'll leave you alone. We're not going to argue about what you know, what came out, because obviously it was working, right? The scientists had helped win World War II. And then only recently, particularly because of climate, you've seen that relationship break. You know, because of climate, There's a group of people who have an issue with science, with the results of climate science. And, you know, climate science doesn't really care. Climate science is just finding the results that it's, you know, that's its job. So they've called the science into question. That's what we call science denial. And that has unfortunately bled into a lot of things, vaccines, other things, GMOs. And so it's becoming very hard now. You know, I think scientists have been kind of surprised, like, look, my job is just to find knowledge. And now suddenly they're thrust into political debates that they kind of weren't prepared for. So, you know, as I tell my students now, you are going to have to be prepared to defend science, you know, for the rest of your life. Science education, science outreach is important to get people to understand its importance. But more than that, it's also to show people how cool science is. Like, you know, science is important not only because it produces cell phones and medical technologies. It's also cool because it just changes your life. It allows you to see how beautiful and extraordinary this world is. And, you know, that may be its most important role, if you ask me. So that, you know, there's dual things. Scientists are there to show people that science is a gateway to a sense of the world being sacred. You know, the world having this inner luminosity that is just mind-blowing. So there's that part, and then there's also the technology part.